Alrighty, today we're going to talk about the voltage drop. Okay, I want to dedicate this to Mike Bunting, the father of Trident Technical College's avionics program. About 3 years ago, Mike, you told me about a voltage drop, and 3 years later, I just want you to know, I got it. Okay, anyway, so what I want to do is I'm going to talk about, you know, we learned about the relationship of voltage and current in Ohm's law. We learned that as current goes up, voltage goes down. Now, one of the things in most components, most things we deal with a fixed resistance. So if I have a fixed resistance, then I know these two are going to react this way. So that's what we're looking at. We're looking at this with a fixed resistance. Now, when I talk about this, one of the more confusing things I think coming up and learning about Ohm's law, and then all of a sudden we throw the voltage drop in here, is that a lot of times when we learn Ohm's law and then we start talking about a voltage drop, we tend to confuse the voltage in voltage drop with the voltage in Ohm's law. And so this is what I want to kind of show you today. One of the things is how a voltage drop is different than the voltage in Ohm's law. Because what we find out is that a voltage drop follows suit with the current. So for example, one of the important things to understand, if the voltage goes down in Ohm's law and current goes up, which voltage are we talking about? So now I have a basic circuit here. I have a 12 volt source, I have one resistor, and I have ground. Now what I want to show you is that the voltage in Ohm's law is the voltage after the load. Okay, and the voltage drop in the circuit is the voltage being dropped across our component or our load in our circuit. So now, what I tend to see that true, if my current is up because I have voltage, current gets through, gets straight to ground. So my current is up, okay, and at the same time, my voltage is 0 volts, it tends to go down. Okay, so my voltage went down, and that would be true to Ohm's law. I have a fixed resistance. Voltage went down when current went up. Okay, but the relationship here I really want you to see, because Ohm's law should be cemented in your brain, is the fact that the voltage drop follows suit with the current. And so when I see my 12 volts, my voltage drop went up, my current went up as well. So this means that without breaking the system and inserting a meter in there to measure amps, to measure my current, I can just read across the resistor and I can see the current in my system, because I know as this current goes up, my voltage drop is going to go up, so I can measure for a voltage drop. Now one of the other things here, just to kind of prove this point, I take that same circuit right here, and what do? I break my ground. Now I no longer have a ground, so since I have no ground, I can't have current flow, because my electrons can't get to ground. So my current is down. Look what happens. My current's down, okay? What happens here is my voltage, the arrow is actually showing you the line, the voltage goes up after the load, okay? And so Ohm's law is true. It worked when I look at this voltage. But my voltage drop did what? It followed suit with my current. It follows my current. So my voltage drop and my current have an equal relationship. They both go down, they both rise and fall together. It's the Ohm's law, so knowing that difference. Now, one of the things I want to propose to you is that because of knowing this, okay, I can become a better troubleshooter. Now, one of the things that we learned very early on is we learned that if we had a circuit breaker, okay, or if we had a switch, okay, and that switch had some built-up resistance here, we learned that that would have a voltage drop across the switch. When the switch is closed, okay, it's going to have a voltage drop. We don't want that. That switch should just be a straight pathway, should be no resistance in that switch. So I would know it's a bad switch because of my voltage drop. Same with my circuit breaker. My circuit breaker is basically just we press it, and it should be a steady flow across. It should be no resistance. And so I know with a voltage drop that that would be bad. Now, I got that. I got that pretty early on. But I really struggled with the idea that there had to be more to a voltage drop. And it was just this year that I really started applying it to further, deeper troubleshooting. So what I want to show you is I want to take you over to the schematic over here, okay? And as we look at this schematic, now this schematic here is of an FM8, an AM-FM radio, okay? Our students build this in communications class 120. And basically what they end up doing is they build it, and sometimes they get bad components. Can't help that, it just happens. So we have to troubleshoot it. And if it does work, don't worry, we're going to break it for them, and they got 15 minutes to figure out where we broke it. A lot of fun. We can thank Mike for that one too. Thank you, Mike. Alright, so anyway, what I want to show you is if I bring my voltage in, I bring it in across my switch, and I come to my very first resistor here, R25. Now R25 is the first point that I'm going to drop voltage. So if I want to see, you know, if my radio is not acting correctly, and I want to see there's a difference. Now this is at the point to where we teach you that you need to have a good component, a good system, and the system that you're checking that's supposedly bad. So what you want to do is I'm going to take the good system, I'm going to measure across this resistor on R25, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to check my voltage drop. I'm going to write down that measurement. Now, so once I write that down, I'm going to now go to my bad system, my system in question, and I'm going to take that voltage drop, and I'm going to write it down. Now, in this case, what I want to propose that my good system had a 3-volt drop. My bad system that I'm trying to check out has a 4-volt drop. Well, if that's the case, what is that telling me? That's telling me that if my voltage drop is higher on my bad system, what's happening? Well, I just talked about that means that my voltage drop is up means my current's up because they share the same relationship. They rise and fall together. So if my voltage drop is up, I've got a high current. Well, if I've got a high current, let's think about it for a second. What happens? I've got a leak. I've got electrons getting to ground. I've got some source of resistance that is not holding back the electrons. And because of that, my system's not working. So now what I propose is that because of that voltage drop, now I just determined I got a leak. But if I look at the rest of the schematic, it gets pretty busy. Now I'm sitting here thinking, how do I isolate that? You know, how do I find it? So one of the things I'm going to do is I've found that I'm going to quickly go down, I'm going to follow my line, I'm going to come down to R9. As I get to R9, I'm going to check for a voltage drop. I'm going to check my good system, I'm going to check my troubled system. And I'm going to look at it, and I'm going to say, hey, and if I tend to have a pretty excessive drop on R9 too, then what I'm going to be looking at here is more than likely my leaky system, my bad resistance is on that side of R9. In this case, we're going to say, you know, it wasn't exactly the same voltage drop, but it wasn't excessive. And so what I've typically found is that it's going to be apparent whether or not it's on one side of R9 or the other. We're going to say it wasn't excessive, so we're going to concentrate our efforts on this system. Now, what I'm going to do in this system is I'm going to come to my components at my grounding points, right above my grounding points, my capacitor and my resistor, and I'm going to take voltage drop readings across those and compare them with my known good system and my troubled system. And what I'm going to find is I'm going to find my leak. I'm going to find my leak because whichever source to ground here has the highest current flow, then I'm going to be able to determine, I'm going to be able to isolate whether it's this system, this, this, or this. Once I isolate it, let's say this right here, I have a high current flow here. Now this is the time that I'm going to have to really get down and troubleshoot. And we know the name of the game is isolate, so we don't spend a lot of time. So what I'm going to do, turn my power off. to remove the voltage, whatever you do. Okay, then I'm gonna go to R22. I'm gonna go to R22, I'm gonna unsolder it. Okay, and I'm gonna lift the leg on it, and I'm gonna check it. I'm gonna check my ohms across R22. I wanna make sure my resistance value is the same resistance value that it's supposed to be. I'm gonna unsolder one side of my capacitor here. I'm gonna do a capacitance check on my capacitor. I need to make sure my capacitor is not shorted out. If those both check out, then I'm gonna check my transistor because I'm gonna see if my transistor is potentially, you know, something's wrong with my transistor, my collector shorted through my emitter. But you should be able to kind of see that just by the basic voltage drop and the importance of current. So being able to find that excessive current flow. So that's the point. So as we come back over here, once again, don't forget your relationships here. Voltage drops rise and fall with current. Ohm's law, we know that voltage, which is the voltage after my load, okay, is gonna drop if my current goes up. We push those relationships and you say, what is the importance? It's gonna be more and more important as you get into becoming troubleshooting and understanding how the system works. Once again, Mike, thanks. I got it.